not be moved. Anchored in Jehovah, I shall not be moved. Just like a tree that's planted by the waters, I shall not be moved. I shall not be, I shall not be moved. I shall not be, I shall not be moved. Just like a tree that's planted by the waters, I shall not be moved. In his love abiding, I shall not be moved. And in him confiding, I shall not be moved. Just like a tree that's planted by the water, I shall not be moved. I shall not be, I shall not be moved. I shall not be, I shall not be moved. Just like a tree that's planted by the water, I shall not be moved. Though all hell assail me, I shall not be moved. Jesus will not fail me, I shall not be moved. Just like a tree that's planted by the water, yes, I shall not.
A nice hand for our piano player this morning, doing a great job. That's old number one. I don't call her Mal anymore. It's just number one. You know, you win the big contest, you got to have that, you know, number one. You know that song, Brother Lee, I Shall Not Be Moved? I starred in that picture Friday night. We were up in Lebanon at a concert, and the sound crew said, get out of our way. We're trying to set up for the next group. Go to the far side of the stage. I had this wise idea to sit down on this piano stool that was rather cheap. All I know is I sit on the edge of the stool, and the next thing I know, I'm flat on my back in front of 800 people. And I knocked the air out of me. And I couldn't catch my breath, and the bad thing is the photographer there, Barbara, she was here when we had the 40th thing, you know, for you, Brother Lee. She starts taking pictures. I could be there taking my final breath going to see Jesus, and she's taking a picture. Anyway, I finally caught my, everybody thought, anyway, it wasn't put on, it just happened. But anyway, that was my theme song this last Thursday night, I Shall Not Be Moved. Are the pictures for sale? No. I got to tell you one other thing. So there was an old boy up there. You can sit down for a second. Sit down. So there was an old boy up there. He's from South Arkansas. His name's Kenny McGrew. He would just fit in real good with us here at Macedonia. Back in June, he's over in Harrison. He had really made a mad dash to get up there for a concert, and the Inspirations were singing. And Kenny said, man, I just rushed to get up here. And I was standing talking to him, and I said, Kenny, can I take your picture? So I took his picture, and he said, what'd you take my picture for? And I said, well, I'm interested in those shoes you're wearing. He had on two different shoes. He said, yeah, I got a pair just like them at home. He said, my daughter thinks I'm losing it anyway. He says, don't show that to her. I said, Brother Kenny, I wouldn't think about it, but I did post it on Facebook. So the Inspirations were singing the other night, and he was there, and I said, Brother Kenny, stand up. This is on the second set. I said, I told about him two different shoes. And so, and anyway, I said, the Inspiration is going to sing a special song for Brother Kenny. And they sang their song called Two Shoes. That don't have a thing to do with this service of Jesus this morning. But anyway, let's sing 137, When We All Get to Heaven. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing His mercy and His grace. In the mansion, bright and blessed, He'll prepare us a place when we all get to heaven. What a day that will be. Sitting here thinking, and we appreciate Rick. I know I said something the other Sunday about Rick, but we appreciate Rick and his guitar playing as well. But I got to thinking, if you add up the rest of their ages, it doesn't come close to Rick's. That just means he's more seasoned, got more experience, you know what I mean? I can't believe he heard what I said, Helen Murray. Does he pay attention to you all the time now that he's home? Oh, my goodness, my goodness. Business meeting this Wednesday night at 7 o'clock after Bible study, all right? Anything else? Well, we came in this morning. We're running over. Sister LaWanda sent me a text about 7 o'clock this morning. I thought, well, I'll sleep in this morning. Anyway, she said, I'm not going to be there. So I contacted Doug. I didn't know if Malley would be awake or not, but anyway, Doug said, she'll do it. What does he call that, Doug? Voluntold? He voluntold her she was going to do it. Anyway, we were running over songs, and I said, we flip through this one. Let's sing this one. Let's do page 171 in that same book, and He'll Hold to My Hand, page 171. Someday when I travel, my last final heave, the call will be coming for me. I'll enter the lifeboat that will be near to carry me over the sea.
Could I say something?
Yes, ma'am. Come right ahead.
While singing that, I couldn't help but think about Clara and her testimony, but also about Rebecca's, and about Rebecca seeing Jesus walking with her mother. It's a true thing. He will hold our hand as we cross over that
Amen.
River. It's not a made-up fantasy story. It's for real, and He's for real, and the comfort and the peace that He gives us is for real.
He'll hold my hand as over death's river I go. Then say, I'll be in beautiful.
last breath here and the first one over there. Brother Lee, I think it's a pretty quick trip. Amen. Let's sing 160. All right, we'll do that one now. 160, what a day that will be. Tithe and offering at this time. The guys are in place and in ready. Let's pray and ask God's blessing upon this part of the service and the remainder of our time in his sweet presence this morning. While they're setting up, I want to brag on Jesus one more time. We had this concert up in Lebanon this week, and you know, gas price has been up and down, economy's been a little bit out there. So we were behind financially, and so we had some people. Anyway, long story short, took an offering Friday night, and just like God always does, he met the need, plus, and then as soon as the offering was taken, then later on in the evening, another guy comes around, and he says, what'd you say the need was? Well, it was quite a figure. I mean, if I had chickens, it'd be quite a few chickens, you know. If I had cows, it'd be quite a few cows. God has always met the need. And the brother said, well, God just told me to write another check for the whole thing. So, now, Dwayne's not super rich, don't get me wrong here. But God has provided a need and a little extra, and I just want to praise his name this morning for taking care of my friends in the ministry as he always does, and he loves and he cares. Well, I just figured we'd let these guys sing a couple or three this morning. Can you do that? Right? Are you wide awake? Well, let's see what you can do. Let's welcome your own Farm Road 1100. How about it? All right. Good.
Who can take a beggar in off the street and give him clean clothes and food to eat? God can.
I know God can.
Who can take a heart to turn bitter and cold and make take away all your pain. Make the sunshine chase the rain. Yesterday, today, and forever the same. All you gotta do is just call his name. Who can put the family back together again? They let their guard down and the devil cracked in. God can. I know God can. Who can reach down to the trembling hand of the child that's abused and they can't understand? God can. I know God can. I know that God can take away all your pain. Make the sunshine chase the rain. Yesterday, today, and forever the same. All you gotta do is just call his name. I know that God can take away all your pain. Make the sunshine chase the rain. Yesterday, today, and forever the same. All you gotta do is just call his name.
While she's moving to the piano, some people didn't bring money last week to buy a CD, so we have CDs to buy. I'm looking at you, Jess. Do you have cash? Good deal.
Keep pressing on every step I've been pardoned. I have been singing every day. I've never been sorry that I trusted his name. Through the dark shadows, he is with me, leading me on the upward way. I've never been sorry that I trusted his name. I've never been sorry that I trusted his name. Every moment I find him exactly the same. My soul has been singing since the Savior came. I've never been sorry that I trusted his name.
All day long I sing the story, praising his name for wondrous love.
I've never been sorry that I trusted his name.
Surely I know a home is waiting, beautiful home in heaven above.
I've never been sorry that I trusted his name. I've never been sorry that I trusted his name. Every moment I find him exactly the same. My soul has been singing since the Savior came. I've never been sorry that I trusted his name.
All day long I sing the storming, making my pathway brighter grow. I've never been sorry that I trusted his name. Never a thought of sad repining. Jesus is with me, this I know.
I've never been sorry
that I trusted his name.
I've never been sorry
that
I trusted his name. Every moment I find him exactly the same. My soul has been singing
every day
since the Savior came. I've never been sorry that I trusted his name. I've never been sorry that I trusted his name. Every moment I find him exactly the same. My soul has been singing since the Savior came. I've never been sorry that I trusted his name. I've never been sorry that I trusted his name.
Last week I spoke from Psalm 23. I think I sort of warned you that I was going to do that again this week, maybe. Or did I just think about it? Did I say something about it? So let's turn to Luke 15, if you would. I've still got it on my mind. I spoke last week from Psalm 23 after I'd studied quite a bit about it. I really wanted to preach from Psalm 23 just from the heart. So we may get back to it in a week or two. Luke 15, how many of you are familiar with the account of the prodigal son? Let's revisit that, would you please? Luke 15, starting with verse number 11. Jesus said, "A certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, 'Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me.' And he divided unto them his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would fain have filled his belly with the husks that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, 'How many hired servants of my father's have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, And I'll say to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and before thee, and I'm no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. And he arose. And he came to his father, but when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. But the father said to his servants, bring forth the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hands and shoes on his feet, and bring hither the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to be merry. Back in this time in Israel and a lot of the Middle East countries, I understand it's much the same. A man's estate went to his children. The older son got a double portion. They divided it into however many pieces that he had sons, and they all got one portion, except there was an extra portion that the oldest son got. He got a double portion. We're dealing this morning with the younger son, and in this case, the man's fortune would have been divided into three pieces. The younger son would have got one portion. The older son would have got two portions, or in this case, two-thirds. It wasn't that they wanted to be unfair. That was just the custom and the law of the land. And that was the way that they did it. But the thing about it is that a son would never come to his father and say, Dad, let me have what I'm going to inherit from you one of these days. That showed great disrespect. It was like the son was saying, Dad, I've been waiting and I don't think you're ever going to die. Why don't you just go ahead and give me what I would get when you do? And it may be strange, but the father agreed to that. Now, notice something in verse 12, the last part of it. We read, he, the father, divided unto them his living. And so evidently he gave not only the portion to the younger son who asked for it, he gave the double portion to the older son who stayed with him and worked for him and continued to do that. But notice what the younger son said. He went up to his father and he said, Dad, give me. They wouldn't do that. He had to be very cheeky to do that. He had to have a lot of disrespect and a lot of gall to ask his dad for his inheritance when the dad was still alive. But let me sidetrack just a little to say, I think that we're in a mentality of this younger son in our country today. People are always saying, give me. So many times it's not, pay me what I have earned, just give me something. I talk to businessmen every once in a while, and they say, we can't get merchandise to sell. And I say, why not? And they say, the manufacturer can't make it fast enough. And I say, why not? And they will say a lot of times, because our people got used to the government stimulus checks that they got in the mail, and they enjoyed that, and they just want to sit home and receive something else like that, and they don't want to come back to work. And we're working with a small crew, and we're not getting enough merchandise made to ship it to you in a good time. I got to be careful. I'm going to get really sidetracked here, but that's one of the things that Well, it bothers me a little bit, to be honest with you. It really does. But the young man came and he said, Dad, give me my inheritance ahead of time. And he did. Now, the young boy was saying something else, I believe, when he said, give me what I'm going to get one day. Let me have it now. Let me enjoy it now and not have to wait. I think he also was saying, give me my independence, because if I have what I'm going to receive from you, I'm not going to have to be dependent upon you any longer, and I can go do what I want to do. In other words, give me my independence. Let me do what I want to do. So he took his inheritance, and he took his freedom, so to speak, and we're told he went to a far country where he celebrated his money and his time. He celebrated by wasting his money. Did you know that there are some of God's people in the Bible, particularly in the Old Testament, who were very wealthy? There were some rich servants that God had, and there were some poor servants that God had. And I have wondered sometimes, well, why can't God treat me like Abraham? And I have a lot of things. Or why can't he treat me like Job, who had a lot of things? Evidently was very wealthy. And then something in the back of my mind comes to me, or the Lord whispers to me or something. Remember the prodigal son. He wasted what he got. Some people can handle it and some people can't. Maybe I'm a can't. Did you ever think about why some folks are richer than you are? Maybe nobody's richer than you. I don't know about your bank account, but I know about mine. Now, the young man's in a far country. He's away from home. His pockets are full of money, and he can do pretty much what he wants to do. And do you know what he did? Can I use a hillbilly term? He blew it all. You know what that means, don't you? He wasted it, according to the scripture. Not just by buying things he didn't need. He wasted it in what the Bible says was riotous living. Now I'm going to jump ahead and then jump back, okay? He ended up, before it was over with, in the pig pen. Let's go back for just a minute to our own pig pen. We don't like to do it. We don't like to think about where we were, where we used to be. And I don't do this very often, but don't worry, we're going to come back home. But let's just think back to where we were before God lifted us out of our pig pen, and why we were there, and how much better it is to be out of there. This young man was in riotous living. It means loose living. It means recklessness, wildness. It means extravagance. It means careless spending. It means drunkenness. It means partying. It means bad language. It means bad dress. It means activities in the wrong bed, if you will. And he got into deep trouble that he couldn't get out of. Some of us have been in deep trouble that we thought we'd never get out of, and would not have had we not been lifted out by the Lord when we called on Him. The results will be worse than we ever thought they would be if we get into riotous living. Somebody, I don't know who it was, but I heard of somebody saying that Satan will take you farther than you want to go. He'll keep you longer than you want to stay. And he'll charge you more than you want to pay. But there's a way out. First point was that the young man said, give me, give me, give me. And the second point is that he met a day when he suffered and was in want. He spent all his money in riotous living. I'm having trouble staying on track, but let me tell you this. We were in Mexico on a mission trip and visiting the missionaries down there and the churches down there, and visited some little churches that were so humble and poor you couldn't believe it. Got to preach in a couple of them. And the people just hung on to every word. One, they were hungry for the gospel, and two, they wondered about an old Anglo speaking Spanish from the pulpit. They couldn't believe it. But this young man, I started to tell you, we had dinner one night in a hotel, restaurant, I guess you'd call it. And there came in a procession of people. One young man was leading the way. And he was in his 20s, probably, and he had a man on each side of him, a young man on each side of him, helping him walk. He was not handicapped. He was not crippled. He was so heavy, he could not walk by himself. And he was dressed in a suit that probably cost hundreds and hundreds of dollars. And they drove in to that restaurant in Monterey in a big Lincoln, a new, big, shiny, fancy Lincoln. Most of the people who had cars had old, small, foreign cars. He had a Lincoln. They ushered him to a prominent place, and all the young people that were following him gathered around, and they ordered food that you wouldn't believe. And it was obvious that this was a rich young man. I read sometime later that one of the richest men in the world had died in Mexico City from overweight and gluttony. I don't know for sure, but I don't think there could have been two people that big, that young. And I think he was the one. This young man, the prodigal son, spent money like that. But he ran out of money. And not only that, he was in a place where there was a disaster. A national disaster came. There was a famine in the land. He had no money. There was no food around. And he suffered humiliation because when he ran out of money, he couldn't spend it to buy food, and he didn't have any. And he went and got a job. Can you imagine the horror of having to get a job and work? He went and got a job. But it was a humiliation because he took a job with a farmer feeding pigs. Why is that a humiliation? Because the Jews looked upon swine as unclean. And they weren't even supposed to touch them, not even touch them as well, or they would be unclean. And he had a job feeding the pigs, if you will. And he was so hungry he would have eaten from the pig troughs. And nobody gave him anything, the scripture says. Now what does that mean? That means that all the friends that were following him, all the friends that were taking from him, as long as he had money, disappeared when he didn't have money. And he was hungry. Number three, he came to himself. Praise the Lord for that. This young man came to himself. He snapped out of his insanity and got a bit of reality back into his life. And he thought in verse 17 about Dad. He didn't have any claim anymore on his father. He didn't have any claim for any kind of inheritance at all. But he remembered and he said to himself, now back home my father has servants, and all those servants, not even family members, all those servants have all they want to eat and plenty besides. It looks to me like, he said, he should have thought earlier, you know. He said, it looks to me like it might be best for me to swallow my pride and go back home and say, Dad, I've done wrong. I've sinned against heaven and I've sinned against you. Go back wrong and say, I've made a terrible mistake. Go back home and say, Lord, I don't have any claim. Would you hire me as a servant? Let me be a servant. He was ready to humble himself. And he was ready to repent. And he was ready to confess his sin and his unworthiness. And that's good, but often we stop there before we actually go into action and do those things. But the next thing is, and he was thinking about it. He was hungry. He knew there was food at home. He hated to do it, but logic said, go home. Go home. We used to hear the song, I believe I'll go home and eat with my father. The table's spread and they're waiting for me. I can see the father coming down to meet me. Lord, I'm willing to be just a servant for thee. And when we get to that point, things begin to look up. My fourth thought is that he did get up, he arose, and he returned to his father. He did repent. He turned from his sinful life and went back to the way he should have been living. And when he went home, notice the scripture tells us he was accepted even before he got there. He didn't have to go all the way home. Dad met him coming around. I picture that. I grew up down by... across this hill and creek from where Mo and Rita lived, down on a little flat. I grew up down on a little flat. And I picture this. When we came out of our little house and looked down the road, there was a curve that went around the road. And I picture Dad out there. The young man's coming from the east. He's walking down that dirt road. And he turns the corner, begins to come around the curve. He's shuffling along slowly because he's barefoot. He had no shoes left. He had nothing left. And as he comes around the corner, even before he gets home, his father sees him. His father calls to the servants and said, somebody's coming. Get your weapons. We don't know who. No, his father recognized him immediately. And he didn't wait till his boy got home. He ran to meet him. And he met him just around the curve. And the young man was true to what he wanted to do. He said, Father, I've sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and I'm not worthy to be your son anymore. And his dad had said, shush, shush, be still. Point five, he was accepted and he returned to the father. In verse 22, the father restored him. He said, servants, go bring him a robe. Go bring him the best robe we've got in the house. And put a ring on his finger, not just to signify money, but to signify he's a part of the family, and give him some shoes for goodness sakes, and let's feed this boy. He looks hungry. And he didn't just feed the boy, he fed him the fatted calf. It's good to go back to the Father. We tend sometimes to drift away. Let me ask you, though, and I'm not going to ask however many of us have ever drifted away a little bit or a big bit, and how many of us may at one time or another have grown cold in our service to the Lord. But let me ask you this. aren't you glad you went back to the Father when you got in a position like that? You did not have to stay in the pig pen. And when you ran back to the Father, He cleaned you up. I just assume we've all done that. And God is faithful to clean us up when we go back. And I'm done with that. No, I've got one more thing. Wait just a minute. Perhaps, could we have a verse of an invitation, Brother Dwayne? Perhaps there could be, I don't have anybody in mind, perhaps there could be somebody in the house this morning that haven't left the pig pen yet and gone back to the Father. He's waiting. He's waiting for you to come back. Would you like to come back this morning? Or if you have never been saved, would you like to come and meet the Lord this morning? Let's stand together while we sing. Father, thank You for Your grace, Your love, Your mercy, Your forgiveness. And we ask You to speak to us this morning. And if there's one here that needs to come and deal with You at this altar, we pray they'd be prompted to do that in Christ's name. Amen. God bless you all. Anyone have a word you'd like to share? All right, remember our service tonight. Brother Jesse will be preaching for us this evening. Come back and pray as you come and look forward to God's presence again. All right, Brother Billy Gray, would you dismiss us in a word of prayer, please?